Hi everyone, welcome to the lab. This time I have a QSC professional power amplifier for repair, model USA850. I was told that both channels are blown, whatever that means, and I see that some screws are missing, so I don't think it makes sense to try powering it up. Let's take a look inside. Let's have a look at the back panel first. The power cord is not detachable. Input is two separate quarter-inch connectors here and also screw terminals here. Two separate gain knobs and a switch here between stereo and bridge mode and massive binding posts. Here we are. We see a massive transformer here, 8 filtering capacitors, 2 bridge rectifiers, 2 missing fuses, this fan. Here we have a board with input connectors and terminals and 2 gain ports. Then 2 socketed op amps, I suppose, 4 transistors, must be drivers of the output stage, and 16 transistors in the output stages, 8 per channel. Let's take a closer look at the output transistors. They seem to be original, I don't see any signs of repair here. And these 8 are identical with date code of 9448 on all of them. They are PNP devices. And these 8 are NPN devices and also identical. Date code is 9507 on all of them. And I don't quite like that they are not exactly complementary. Perhaps they are close enough so it doesn't matter much, but still, these are MJ15023 and complementary would be 15022, and these are MJ21194 and complementary would be 21193. So I'm not entirely sure why this slightly strange choice. Here is the bottom side, and look at this. All transistors in the output stages appear to be shorted. So I think it's time to start desoldering things. Here we are, all transistors are desoldered, and it turns out that 5 of them are shorted and the rest look fine. Let's see, these are NPN ones, so 2 shorted NPNs, there you go, and these are PNP devices, and so on, and these look okay, so this is the base, I believe, so we should see a diode this way, then nothing the other way around. And nothing between collector and emitter. Fine, and these are PNPs, so negative on the base, diode this way, nothing the other way around, and nothing between collector and emitter. So these look fine. And just to have an additional test, I have this little tester here. And I hooked up one of the NPNs. There you go, NPN. And now let's hook up one of the PNP transistors. There you go, PNP transistor. Here is a service manual with circuit description, troubleshooting steps and schematic diagrams for 3 models, USA370, 850 and 1300. As we will see, they are quite similar. Here is a test procedure, and in particular, look at this step, short circuit current. Apply a short to the output binding posts of each channel, one channel at a time, and adjust the short circuit current limits. So, these amplifiers are designed to survive short circuit on the output terminals. Here is the circuit description with many interesting details, but I would like to emphasize one particular aspect having to do with the output stage. Note that the collectors of all output transistors meet at a common ground. This is possible because of the special power supply arrangement outlined earlier. This means we can simply screw the cases to a grounded heatsink with no need for the usual insulating mica. This saves money and improves reliability through better cooling. The speaker output is taken from the midpoint of the power supply capacitors. This means that the audio output voltage is superimposed on top of the DC supply voltages, which must be kept in mind when checking these voltages. Here is the schematic of the Model 370, and this is one of the channels of the power amplifier. And as we can see, there are two transistors in parallel on each side of the output stage. And as we have seen in the circuit description, collectors are connected to the common ground and on this side as well. And emitters are connected through these load sharing resistors to the negative rail on this side and to the positive rail on this side. And bases are connected together and go to the previous stage transistor driving the output stage. And this is the midpoint of the power supply mentioned in the circuit description between these two electrolytic caps. And this goes to the positive output terminal. And the negative output terminal is connected to the common ground, so there is no problem probing this output using a regular Earth-referenced oscilloscope. And here is the schematic for our Model 850. And it is almost identical, but there are more transistors on each side and more capacitors here. And if we look at the next schematic for the Model 1300, there are even more transistors here and more capacitors. So, I'm thinking about using just one pair in the output stage, just to see if everything else works, and we need to test these transistors in the previous stage as well. I desoldered these two transistors. They are Q2A and B. PNP devices driving the negative side of the output stage in both channels, and they are shorted. And the same thing with this guy, but the NPN devices driving the positive side of the output stage look fine. I also found two blown resistors. They are between emitters of these transistors and the ground, and they are 6.8 ohm 1 watt flameproof resistors. Finally, we have parts to start the repair. Unfortunately, I couldn't get these transistors through serious distributors like DigiKey or Mouser. I had to order them on eBay from China, and I had to wait for quite a while. I hope they are genuine parts. They were sold as pairs with corresponding NPN devices, but they look fine, so I'm inclined to leave them alone for now. I also have these resistors from DigiKey and these 12 amp slow blow fuses. Unfortunately, this sticker here does not say if fuses should be fast or slow, and the manual does not say as well, and the original fuses are missing, but I am quite sure they should be slow fuses, because they need to survive the spike of current during power up, when this bank of capacitors starts charging. And we have 11 output stage power transistors, which seem to have survived out of 16, but let's use just one pair in each channel for now. This should be enough to get started. Alright, new transistors here, new resistors, new fuses, minimal output stage, And I checked many other components like capacitors, diodes and such. They seem to be fine, but of course I might have missed something. So it's time for a smoke test. Here is my test setup, let's take a look. I'm using this Keysight scope with built-in function generator, putting out 1 kHz, 100 millivolts peak to peak, which is connected to this. First of all, BNC to RCA adapter, then RCA splitter, and finally RCA to TRS adapters. So I can plug this into both channels here. Then both gain knobs here are set to about 12 o'clock. Then channel 1 of the scope is connected to channel 1 output of the amp here. And the second channel of the scope goes to the second channel of the amp here. And we are going to use this variable isolation transformer. We are going to slowly bring the voltage up and watch the current. If it goes too high, then something is wrong. Let's go. We see some DC offsets. The fan started. And there you go, channel 2 started working, but channel 1 has only some DC offset. So, something is wrong with channel 1. I swapped two socketed op amps here, and now look at this. We have just the opposite picture. Channel 1 is working. So we need a new op amp. The original op amp is NE5532, and I don't have a replacement handy at the moment. But I do have LM833, which looks quite similar. The pinout is the same, of course. And some parameters are even better, like lower noise and lower input offset. But some other parameters are not quite the same. Let's say this one can tolerate up to plus minus 22 volt rails, but this one only plus minus 18. But we have plus minus 15 volt rails in the amp, so this should be fine, I suppose. Also, this thing can dissipate up to 1100 milliwatts. And this one only 500. I'm not sure this is important. And there are some other differences. I believe this one is slightly faster. And there are some other minor differences. So I'm thinking about ordering the right ones later on if everything else is fine. But for now I think we can use this one for testing just to get started. Especially if we don't push it too hard. Look at this, we have both channels working now, but the transistors are running too hot, even idling, and the current seems to be too high, more than 1 amp, and we have no load at all, and the amplitude here is low anyway, about 2 volts peak to peak. I think this is because the bias is way off for this configuration. So let's turn this off for now. Let's see, how can we proceed? This amp is quite old and does not have much value at this point. I'm not sure exactly, let's say from $100 to $200. So I don't want to spend too much money fixing it. We have 7 more transistors, which are probably fine. So the cheapest way would be to use 2 more pairs, put them in, readjust the amp for this configuration, and that should be equivalent of the model USA370. I don't really want to go that way, I just wanted to mention this option. On a closer look at the schematic, I don't think this is a very good idea. There is an important difference between models 370 and 850 besides the number of transistors in the output stage. This schematic is for the Model 370, and look at the power rails. Plus and minus 54 volts, as opposed to plus and minus 76 volts in the Model 850. So, populating here just two pairs instead of four without lowering this voltage is going to make the output stage underpowered and it can be potentially overloaded. And lowering this voltage is not possible without replacing this transformer, which is out of question. But of course we should be able to populate just two pairs here for testing, so we can test this thing under some load, if we are careful and don't push it too far. The next option would be to buy 5 replacement transistors of exactly the same type as the dead ones, assuming these 11 are fine. Here they are on DigiKey. These are PNP transistors MJ15023 for $7 a piece. And here are NPN transistors MJ21194 also for $7 a piece. So if I go this way, I will pay $35 plus tax and shipping, let's say slightly over $40. Not cheap at all. So I found one more option here on eBay. Two pairs or four pieces, MJ15022 and 23, for just $4 and free shipping from China. And of course I worry that these might not be genuine parts, but this looks quite tempting. This means that for $16, slightly more, plus tax, let's say under $20, I can replace all of them. I am tempted to give this a try. Here they are. And look at this, they have arrived in just bubble envelope and piled into these regular plastic bags. Not anti-static and no protection for the pins whatsoever. And sure enough, some pins are bent, and do you see these small chunks of this blue insulation around the pins? So it must have chipped somewhere around some pins. Oh, how stupid is this? I worried about them not being genuine, but now I'm worried even more that they might be damaged. I experimented with these new cheap replacement transistors from China, and sorry I did not record all the steps, let me tell you what happened. First of all, in this amplifier, the high voltage power rails are completely separate in each channel, two separate bridge rectifiers, two separate banks of capacitors, and two separate fuses. So it is possible to run one channel and disable the other one by removing one of the fuses, and that is mentioned in the service manual. So I put one new pair of transistors into channel A, put one fuse in and started increasing the mains voltage. And as we have seen before, around 80 volts, let's say, the channel started working. But when the voltage reached about 110 volts, the transistors went puff, and a couple of 22 ohm resistors here started glowing red. So I quickly turned the voltage down, and the resistors seem to have survived. But both transistors have shorts now between the base and the collector. So I took one more pair and put it into the other channel. I moved the fuse and tried the same thing again. And exactly the same thing happened, except that this pair of 22 ohm resistors in that channel went open circuit. And then I took one original pair of transistors, put them into the channel A, where the resistors seem to have survived. And sure enough, as we have seen before, that configuration worked fine. So, I think I have to conclude that these cheap replacement transistors from China are fake. And now I need another plan. So, I'm thinking about going back to that idea of using four original pairs of transistors for now. And if that works, we will worry about the next steps at that point. Here is 122 ohm resistor on the positive side, and this is the other one on the negative side. And if transistor is shorted base to collector, the resistor is going to be between the ground and the 76 volt rail. Here I ordered some 22 ohm resistors. 1 watt resistors are specified in the service manual. But the actual resistors on the board seem to be larger, so I bought some 2 watt resistors, and they seem to be the right size. And they had only 7 of them left on DigiKey, so I bought all of them. And I also bought the right op amps. They are quite cheap. Alright, 4 original pairs of transistors are installed, 22 ohm resistors replaced. Let's try to adjust and test this configuration. Now I'm measuring voltage across 2 emitter resistors of these 2 driver transistors in channel A. This is to adjust bias. The voltage should be the same approximately, and it should be around 100 millivolts according to the service manual. It was a bit too high, around 150. So I adjusted the trim pot there to make it approximately 100 millivolts. And now the same thing in channel B. Imbalance is a bit greater here for some reason. We have seen a couple of millivolts difference in channel A, but here the difference is about 9 millivolts. Maybe these resistors are slightly off, or gain of the driver transistors is different, or Zener diodes are off a bit, or something else. I'm not sure if it's a problem or not. Now let's try with the load. I have this power resistor, 8 ohms, 50 watts, and the amplifier is capable of way more than 50 watts, even in this limited configuration. So this resistor is going to be our limiting factor. And 50 watts of power into 8 ohm load corresponds to 20 volts RMS or 56 volts peak to peak. Test setup is ready. The function generator is set to produce 1 kHz, 1.4 volts peak to peak, just enough to achieve what we want, connected to channel A at the moment. First channel of the scope is monitoring the voltage across the load resistor. Peak-to-peak voltage measurement is here, and by the way, watch the AC amps there as well. I'm going to crank up the gain knob. Let's go. Oh, this is about 56 volts peak-to-peak. Let's see, this guy is hot. And now the same test for channel B. Moved the input, moved the output, let's go. This is about 56 volts peak to peak. No problem. I am going to stop at this point. I believe we have seen all the interesting technical details. At this point, the problem mostly is not a technical one, but financial. I do want to restore this thing, but I'm not sure how to proceed with this. Mixing old and new transistors is not ideal, but even that is not very cheap, and replacing all of them is almost beyond economical repair. The whole amplifier might not be worth that much. Let me know what you think in the comments below. And thanks for watching. Bye.